we only have a limited amount of time every year to actually produce a crop. Everything has to happen like clockwork. A lot of Americans don't realize just how tenuous our food supply is.
We've got enough stress. We're worried about bugs, we're worried about the markets, we're worried about whether or not China's buying corn. But we can see the weather. Climate change is absolutely real for farmers because we're living it.
If we can improve our soils to where our soils are now a buffer for the extreme weather changes that we're seeing, we're going to see more stable yields.
The future of the country is at stake. And we need to get the message out to people. We have a lot of allies and a lot of friends in towns and in the cities. They just need to know we're out here and we need help. The fact that agriculture just doesn't make an adequate income to support families is what it's all about. There are all kinds of people that want to go back to the farm and ranch. They loved their life on that farm or that ranch. It's all they want to do. But the income isn't there.
If you look at farming today and you look at like corn prices, are you kidding me? Am I going to do that? I have to work 7 days a week for that? You can work a lot less and make more money and have more time off in a different occupation than farming. You can't work 7 days a week for your whole life. You just can't do it.
Cannot raise products below the cost of production and stay in business. The older farmers like me are going to decide to quit. The younger farmers that are coming along, there's nobody going to finance them because you don't finance a fellow when he's going to show you a loss rather than a profit.
Right now we grow commodities. I grow corn that goes to chickens that gets eaten by people. So you don't really think of it as food. It's very difficult to. I mean, we're trained not to because that's how we make our living. And I think that people need to realize that this is their food and they should demand to know how it's grown.
Ever since we did that and got back with our original lawyer, he said he would go forward with it, but I can't even get him to respond to an email to find out what the status of that application is.
I see. I'm so sorry to hear about that.
There's only two ways to become a farmer. You're either born into it or you marry into it. Otherwise, there's really no other way for a person just to say one day, I want to farm. Because the startup costs are just astronomical.
This tractor, brand new, is $180,000. Now, that was 2013. You got an alternator that runs it, just like a car. You've got all these hydraulics that run it. The hydraulic pump, if it goes out, is $10,000. You blow a tire, you're looking at $1,600. Front ones are $800. We just put new ones on there last year. The planter, this thing right here, to set it up alone, the technology is $60,000. The planter itself was $130,000. And then you add the monitor, the GPS, and you're up to $200,000 automatically. So all together, this is $380,000. This is a 5-bedroom house with a swimming pool in the back.
All our modern machinery is pretty much operated by electronics and software, and we're prevented by the manufacturers of actually accessing certain parts of that machine. You know, we don't have the tools to diagnose our equipment anymore. The dealership won't even sell it to us. So here we are, you know, I've got a wheat crop, I've got a harvest. I've got a wheat crop that's deteriorating in the field as we speak. I've got weather systems coming in that could potentially ruin my wheat crop. I can't be waiting for the dealership to send a technician out with a laptop to hook up to the combine. You know, farmers are known to be very resourceful, to take whatever resources they have at hand and make things work. I should have the ability to get the same resources as a dealership does to diagnose my machine, to repair my machine.
When there's not farm businesses that are healthy around the area, they don't buy as much stuff in town. So those businesses shutter up their windows. And if you have less and less young people coming back that have a chance to get into, in our areas, into food production. So what happens if young people have no direct route, no way to be able to purchase land and get on the land with a path to ownership?
To buy a farm, to buy a good ranch that can support yourself on, I'm going to say you probably have to have around 5,000 acres where I live. That's going to be $3 million minimum. Most people have no way to come up with that cash. So the land is sold to a bigger entity, whether that be corporations from out of the state or out of the country.
There's a lot of discussion today about ownership of farmland. There are international parties that are trying to buy it. We see large companies that are coming in trying to buy it. Well, there was a time when Made American truly meant that. But nowadays, we need to, I think, be very careful as to who we allow in as owners of our food producing assets.
Land. I'm a tenant farmer, and I've been farming about 8 years now. I'm not inheriting farm or land, but like, I don't need 500 acres. I don't need 200 acres. Like, if I had 200 acres, I'd love to collaboratively farm that with others and like do livestock and do different type of enterprises all together. So I'm really looking for maybe 5 acres, but I still can't afford to buy 5 acres right now. And when you get out into these rural communities, a lot of the dwellings and the places to live, they're gone. So to find 5, 10 acres or something like that with a house that you could live in with your family is really hard.
Look over here, then it'll be better.
We need to get serious about figuring out how to grow food on smaller acreages, because if you can grow food efficiently and effectively on smaller acreages, then you can transition either through leasing or purchasing smaller amounts at a time. The ownership structure of agriculture and food production needs to change. We need to have more ownership by workers and by people who are doing the physical labor.
When we raise corn, soybeans, we're fairly dependent upon the Board of Trade to dictate the price. And we can make more money sequestering carbon in the carbon markets. That's something that's unique to plants with photosynthesis that are actually taking CO2 out of the air. Well, this leads to a whole new business opportunity. We can capitalize on this so that our next cash crop is carbon farming. A very unique way that we can add value and keep farmers on the farm.
To me, carbon should be my new cash crop. It should be a commodity. No doubt, the biggest carbon footprint most people have is their food. But if you don't know the carbon footprint of your food, how do you know you're buying responsibly? Do you know where the organic produce came from? Organic chicken, where did the feed come from? Did it come from Argentina? Did it come from Australia? To feed a chicken that then got processed? Is it better for the planet? But there's no way to know. I'm a farmer and don't know.
As a row crop farmer, we grow cash crops about 4 months out of the year. That leaves a full 8 months of opportunity that we could have something growing on our land, even if we're not growing it as a cash crop that we're going to actually harvest. It's plants that can be sequestering carbon from the atmosphere and putting it back into the soil.
Regenerative agriculture lowers our cost of production, and it also increases the soil organic matter. And with cover crops, it increases our soil's ability to absorb moisture. So when we do get these heavy rains and stuff, it doesn't all wash off. We're protecting our soil from wind erosion, water erosion. We've been more profitable than we would be without regenerative agriculture. And along with that, we can be monetizing it now through the carbon markets.
My grandfather farmed this land in the 20s and 30s. One of the things that he inculcated into me was, hey, you know, you're a steward of the land. You need to make sure that it's better than it was when you inherited it, when you pass it down to your children. We started in about 2014 in precision agriculture, but taking the technology that we were familiar with in the military service and using it in sustainable or regenerative agriculture. What we need to be able to do is manage our crops, our fields, down to as small an area as we can. And in order to do that, you have to have the capability of developing what we call situational awareness. And you have these platforms where you bring this data in, you fuse it, and you analyze it, and you're able to act on it.
Most farmers will look where they can make money. And the healthier the soil is, the better chance you'll have to make a higher yield. And with those improvements in technology, we've been able to eliminate trips over the field, save fuel, and make our farming operations more profitable with less inputs. And by using cover crops, we can save our topsoil, we can increase the profitability of the farmland, we can reduce the amount of soil as well as fertilizer, herbicides, and pesticides going into rivers and streams and being wasted.
One of the projects that we've been pursuing is measuring the amount of carbon in soil. And that's important because what that does is it gives a boost to the carbon market because you have a better understanding of actually what's there from year to year if you can measure it rather than just doing a lot of modeling and estimating.
So farmers are the reason that we can have negative carbon feedstocks going into our plant. Connecting carbon markets through our fuels and our final users of those fuels, we are doing everything we can to incentivize those best practices in ag, so regenerative agriculture, to the final fuel. And connecting those systems is how you really build that value versus just a carbon market on its own. And by having a fuel that we can have a higher value on because it's a low carbon fuel or a zero carbon fuel, is how we are connecting those systems to be as efficient as possible.
I think a market for carbon is one of the only ways to get farmers into regenerative agriculture at a wide scale. And at the end of the day, if I'm gonna go broke putting carbon back into the soil, I'm probably not gonna do it. If I'm gonna see some kind of incentive, whether it's through the value-added aspect of a product or through a direct payment, I'm probably more likely to do it.
If they can't make a profit, I don't care what you show them, they're not interested. And it's been said since I started farming, and we still say it, we'd rather have the market than to have the subsidy. If we got the right market, we don't need no subsidy. If we don't have the right market, somebody's got to subsidize or there won't be a farm.
The state of Maryland pays me to cover crop, and that's what got me to start cover cropping. No-till and cover crop are what sequester carbon into the ground. So that subsidy, because I didn't believe in cover crops, I thought it was just the environmentalists telling me what to do. But since they were paying me, I was willing to listen. And that's what transformed our farm into farming the way we do. But it was through that initial subsidy that made it work. But as we start to figure out how to get that carbon footprint of the food to the consumer, we need a stepping stone. We need something in between, and I think that's the carbon markets. I think the carbon markets come in and vet what everyone does. You've got people on the ground checking the soil to make sure that the carbon's there. So then I have a product that's marketable. It has a numerical value of how much carbon was sequestered in the soil and the growing of that product. And I'm not a huge believer in the government taking over markets, but I think where we need the government and where we need policy is in the vetting of the markets. How do we know as a farmer, now that there's 10 or 15 different markets to sell carbon on, how do we know which ones are good and which ones are not?
The order declares meat plants as critical infrastructure. At least 20 meatpacking workers have died from COVID-19, more than 5,000.
We've seen during COVID-19 what one break in the chain in our food supply can cause of actually getting the product to the grocery stores. And that was only just a brief disruption of our food supply. What if we have an even worse drought than what we had in 2007? That disrupts food supply over the entire country. The key to a secure food supply is spreading production over a large number of producers over a wide area. We need everybody producing in each state in the country so we can mitigate any potential disasters we will have in a given year.
Through all the things that happened with COVID and the pandemic, our tribe is really taking it serious now about developing food security in our communities. We have about 1,000 acres of organic crops growing, from corn to wheat to alfalfa, oats, and we even have organic field peas this year. A lot of this stuff was driven by the lack of access to fresh, nutritious foods in Winnebago. And we've gone away from things like this, growing our own food. Now we're getting all these food production into our schools, into our hospitals, into our local food stores, and just getting people to start eating better. On top of that, increasing the physical health, the mental health. I think it's extremely important that a lot of rural communities start to plan longer term for the food security within their communities. Not only is it going to help give you that reassurance of food, but I think it brings back a sense of community. It brings back a sense of connection to the land that you're around.
We're getting beat down by weather that old-time farmers have never seen stuff like this before. It just seems like it's getting more and more unpredictable, more extreme. And it's like, holy cow, if you don't believe in climate change, it's insane. It's so obvious.
Well, I've been farming since 1973, and I've never seen weather patterns like we've had the last few years. Either we have way too much rain or no rain. We have mild winters where it hardly ever freezes. We have the coldest weather on Earth. We have a 100-year flood here every 5 years. This isn't normal, and what we're seeing is the extremes are now the norm. Farming is maybe not quite as labor-intense as it was, but it's a lot more mentally stressful than it has been. And we're seeing this all across rural America. We're seeing farmers struggling with depression and everything else.
This year, we've had a big soybean crop, and it's typically shipped down to New Orleans. And then right before harvest, Hurricane Ida comes in and damages a lot of those grain facilities down there. And all of a sudden, our price that we're set to receive for our crops drops like a rock. When you throw in those kinds of stresses where you do everything you can all year long, everything's perfect. And then at the last moment, a severe storm comes in that doesn't even affect your area, but affects another part of the country. It's enough to make you wonder, why are we doing this? What's the point of banging our heads against the wall? Is there no end in sight to some of the added stresses that we're having to face due to these extreme weather events?
My brother and I, we both vowed to keep the farm and the family no matter what, and farm first, even if we had other businesses, like we made that pact. My brother's a true believer in that as I am, and knowing all that blood, sweat, and tears that our ancestors put in to give us a chance to be on this land.
For sure.
Feel pretty lucky about that, and that's worth fighting for.
I mean, that's what brought me back. Like, I was an IT major. I moved to DC for 10 years, you know? Like, I had a career out there. I came back to the farm for family. So we have an obligation to make the farm successful because Dad sacrificed everything to make it work.
Yeah.
And we're fifth generation. I mean, you know, it's not just Dad. It was, you know, it was generations before him. So better not screw it up.
I've got mixed emotions about the potential of my kids coming back to the family farm. I mean, on one hand, obviously, I'd be proud. You know, this farm has been in our family at this location since 1882, and I'm the fifth generation to run it. That's a fact I'm extremely proud of. And if one of my kids could be the sixth generation, I mean, I don't think anything could make me prouder. And if it's what they feel called to do, then I'm in 100% support. But on the other hand, I've got smart kids. I've got kids who I feel can do anything they put their mind to. And I really don't want to see them come back to this way of life and struggle.
How do you bring more people back to agriculture and have a sound connection with the land and with the animals on the land and the food that is produced on the land? How do you incentivize it? And policy is a big piece of the puzzle. We need to rework the Farm Bill in a big, big way.
The problem with federal farm policy is that our needs here in the Southeast are different than farmers' needs in the Midwest or out West. But they've got a one-size-fits-all policy that really doesn't come close to filling anybody's needs. It's better than no support at all, but there's so much that can be improved on.
We need to rebuild rural America. We need to redo it from the bottom up. And we want to be at the table with legislators and policymakers. And so when it comes to the Farm Bill, we need to be the mouse that roared, and we need to get in there and say how we want to help better our communities and better our nation.
farmers and ranchers, people who produce food, are affected very drastically by public policy. But in the past, farmers and ranchers haven't been so willing to talk to folks from the city or eager to talk to folks in organized labor or in meatpacking plants. We need to set aside what we might perceive our differences because we're all trying to make a living in the same economic system. And we've got to be able to see how those things connect to each other. Everyone eats food. Everyone has some small part in the agriculture system.
The climate is changing. Farmers need to be put in a lead role to help mitigate the situation. And we need good policy that can help protect us in these changing times, as well as protect all the consumers that depend on us to raise a good food product for them. And so this is a call to action to help transition the farmer to regenerative agriculture. Because regenerative agriculture is the best weapon we have to fight the climate crisis.
Show me.